Now, first of all, offer millions and millions of Dandava pranams unto the lotus feet of my most beloved Gurudev, Nitya Lila Pravishta Om Astapta Rishi Shimai Shiva Bhakti Vedanta Narayan Goswami Maharaj. And the same again, millions and millions of times, unto the lotus feet of our most beloved Nitya Lila Pravishta Om Astapta Rishi Shimai Shiva Bhakti Vedanta Swami Shiva Prabhupada. And all the Vaishnava and Vaishnavi devotees, headed by the Chidambi Sannyasi Guru, which are called Bhakti Vedanta Shwati Maharaj, Dandava Pranams. So, I've been speaking on the childhood pastimes of Krishna in relationship to his killing the different demons, and I try to bring out a mood of Braj, a mood of Vrindavan that is accentuated by the pastimes with the demons, in particular the relationships amongst the Brijvasis. Vrindavan Dham itself is a kingdom of moods, of sweetness, of exchanges, of feelings. This is actually the nature of Gokul. How are all the different Brijvasis feeling towards each other, but specifically towards Krishna as the object? If we sometimes read the Rasa Shastras, the Rasa Tattva in particular, in Jiva Dharma, chapter 27, 28, those chapters, it's describing the details of those moods or feelings, those bhavs towards Krishna. So our process, we know, is sadhana bhakti, bhava bhakti, and prema bhakti. Unless our sadhana bhakti is focused on bhava bhakti, then really our sadhana is quite meaningless. Priti sadhya bhavat sadhiva sa sadhana vida nitya siddhyasya bhavasya prakritam visadhita. This nitya siddhyasya bhavasya is residing in the heart of the jivas, eternally, in potential. And this will be watered and brought out by association with high-class devotees and the mercy of Guru. So we're working our way through this 10th canto, and each time I've spoken, I've mentioned the other 9 cantos. I've told the different pastimes in the different cantos, I've told the different subject matters that are described in the 2nd canto, in the 10th chapter, in that first verse, Atrasago Vishagashta, Stanam Poshanam Utaya Manvanta Rishanam Bhavo Niroda Mukti Ashraya, those 10 subject matters. But the very essence, as we've described, is actually in the 10th canto. And it's very confidential. Why is it confidential? Because of its intimacy of sweetness and speciality. As I described previously, the other 9 cantos are in a mood of majestic worship towards Krishna. And it's only at the end of the 9th chapter, in 9th canto rather, in the 28th chapter, when the Yadu dynasty is introduced and Parikshit is inquiring about Krishna, that Shukadeva Goswami has revealed there. And then Shukadeva Goswami becomes ecstatic and he enters the 10th canto and begins these very confidential, sweet, warm, beautiful pastimes with the backdrop of the natural setting of Braj. So in a previous class I drew a map and we got something of a picture of the 5 main forests on the eastern side, Gandhiravan, Madhuravan, Mayavan, Mahavan, and Lohavan. They're all on the eastern side of the Jamuna. The eastern side, if you're standing in Gopinath Bhavan, you see the sun rising in the east across the other side of the Jamuna. That's the eastern side of Braj. And on this other side of Braj, then we have Madhuban, Taravan, Mahulavan, Kadirvan, then Vrindavan itself, then Kamulavan, and Kamyavan. So these seven forests on the western side. So I try to encourage you to become attentive to just the geography alone, because it will help us walk into Braj directly. Being in Vrindavan, Tanna Rupa Charita Adi Sukirtana Shmitya Kravana Rasana Mansidhyoja Tishte Braji Kandurahi Janugami. This is the essence of all advice described by Rupa Goswami in his Upadeshamrita. To be living in Braj under guidance of those purest Vrijabhasis. This is our Siddhanta. This is the heart. So coming into these pastimes is essential. And our beloved Gurudev, just now, he was speaking the glories of the Bhagavatam. And there's a very beautiful verse by Sanatana Goswami.
Madeka bandhu mat sangin mat guru mat mahadane mannirastaka mahabhagya madananda namostute.
This is by Sanatana Goswami in his Krishna Lila Stava. And this means, O holy Bhagavat, you are my only company, you are my only friend, my guru, you are my greatest treasure, my personal savior, the emblem of my best fortune, the very form of ecstasy. I offer obeisances to you. So all of the acharyas, it's a very beautiful verse. And Srila Gurudev in particular, just now, how many times did he say Bhagavatam, Bhagavatam, Bhagavatam? These were the very last words he ever spoke when he left the American continent. Is just take shelter of Srimad Bhagavatam. The essence of Srimad Bhagavatam is in the 10th canto. And the essence of the 10th canto is in the Rasa Panchadiya chapters. But as a prelude to there, to build our qualification, we can dwell and hear these very sweet, innocent-like pastimes of Krishna and his cowherd boyfriends in Braj. So I tried to explain many of the different details of each demon and all of the different aspects of that lila. So we won't have time to cover all the demons, but still we've had a good innings. We've done quite a few. There'll just be a few left for your own, you know, study and contemplation. So there was Putana first, right? How old?
3 days.
And then the next demon? Shakatasura. Shakatasura was how old, Krishna? 3 months. 3 months. Next demon? Trinavrata. How old?
1 year.
1 year. Yes, exactly 1 year. He's in Kumara age. We can map these demons, as I've said previously, according to Krishna's ages. So this Balya Lila, Kumara Lila is first. And then after Trinavrata was the chastisement of the two sons of Kubera, Nali Kubera, one Kubera. And then after those two, Krishna takes the calves grazing, and the first demon he kills alone in the pasturing grounds is Vatsasura. And Krishna's about 4.5 years old. Then after then it's Bakasura, that huge mountain-like duck demon. And Krishna was about 5 years old. Then after Bakasura, Agasura. This is like a turning point here, because Krishna's age is on the cusp of Poganda. So it's a very important, and it's such a huge demon. This demon Agasura, as I said before, was terrifying even the demigods. So with his demise, all the demigods were very pleased. And then after Agasura, this most ecstatic pastime of the Brahma Vimohanila. That's always connected with Agasura, because Agasura's soul went into the body of Krishna and Lord Brahma becomes very confused. So you see here there's a thread. Now, in this time of the Brahma Vimohanila, Krishna comes to his age of Pauganga, 6 years old, which means he's eligible for marriage. So all of the gopis of Vrindavan are engaged to the other cowherd boys who are all Krishna. So in fact, Krishna marries all of the young girls of Braj during that time. So this is the Brahma Vimohanila. And then after the Brahma Vimohanila, who remembers the next pastime?
Fire?
No, before the fire, Deinukasura. Deinukasura. Krishna is about 7 years old, and he's challenged by the young boys that their hunger demon has come up. So they go to the forest of where?
Talavan.
And Baladev Prabhu, I described because he was a little restless, not being told about the Brahma Vimohanila to the end, didn't actually come out for 5 days. And then these are the demons of Braj. We can say Baladev is killing them, Krishna is killing them. The demons of Braj. Huh?
Guru feels ignorant.
Yes, in the form of Baladev. So then after Deinukasura, who remembers who was next? No, not yet. We've got Kalia today. Kalia, this massive 1,000-footed serpent, Kalia. So that was the last pastime that we spoke last week, was Kalia and Kalia's history. Okay? Yes.
Is there a correlation
between
demons and Krishna?
I haven't. She's asking, is there a correlation between the different demons and what they represent? I haven't noticed that, and I haven't read that by Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur or any of the commentators, Srila Vishnachandra Thakur. They seem to get bigger and bigger, because Krishna actually gets bigger and bigger.
So we have heard that in spiritual life, first of all, Guru is Guru.
Yes. So in that sense, Rajanath is pointing out, like Putana is the first demon. So until false Guru can be removed, then nothing else can. Is that fair, Hakimor? I have to shout so loudly because it's really intriguing. It's quite crazy. Just turn it off. Creates a lot of pressure. Thank you.
Very strong, Brenda. You're very strong.
Okay, Trinivarta's gone. Thank goodness. Okay, so I've said before, if any of you want a list of these demons and the sequence, etc., just give me your email and I'll send it to you. So in answering this question, certainly Putana is distinctly mentioned as being the first demon to purify this false guru. And Kamsa knows this is described, and he tries to put Putana in first. Because once false guru is there, then everything will be annihilated. Everyone will become Mayavada in person, etc. So Putana has to be destroyed straight away. But the other demons, I haven't read any specific evolution of their, you know, purifying states of consciousness. These are all anartas that have to be purified. But more than this, try not to just focus on this, because I noticed that Srila Prabhupada wasn't specifically focusing on this, and I haven't focused on this in the last 8 or 9 days when I've spoken, because he hasn't really, he's mentioned it, but it hasn't been the priority. He wants to use the excuse, so to speak, of descriptions of these demons to describe us the wonderful backdrop of Goloka Vrindavan, of Sri Vrindavan. This is what he wants to take us into, that land of the spiritual kingdom. This is the place, this is our Prayojan Tattva. This is the place to meditate while we're chanting. This is the place where you're going to get some juice from, some spiritual nourishment from the meditation of these aspects. So the descriptions of the demons are important to some degree. The anartis is said, but not really the principle.
Question. You keep mentioning note Vishu's age. So I wonder what is this? Obviously, goes into Koganda, right? He goes into that stage of his growth. But what you say, he's 3 months, 3 days, 3 months, 1 year. What does that really mean, other than that he goes into Koganda, where he goes into where
to try and link in our consciousnesses, which are conditioned, my consciousness is conditioned, maybe I'm sure yours is or more
much more,
but no, in a conditioned consciousness it's easier to get a thread according to the time sequence. These demons are all Lamitika. They don't appear in the original land of Aprakat, Golok, Gokul, Vrindavan. They are happening in this world of Boma Vrindavan for the pastimes. So Krishna, in his Boma Vrindavan Leela, he is a child, and then eventually he is a personality of 125 years old. He goes through this spectrum of age. So for us to gather a picture of that life span, you can say, of Krishna in Boma Leela, then we can map it according to his ages, from his birth in Kamsa's dungeon, to his finally taking all the Brijvasis back after Dantabhakara to Gokul. So we can see, just like in the life of any personality, how would you, like we talk about the life of Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati or Shankaracharya, and we talk about their birth, and we talk about their leaving this world. So in the same sense of Krishna, but understand simultaneously that there is no birth for Krishna, there's no unmanifest, there's just unmanifest pastimes for Krishna. He's never born.
It's one of the things that you have common desires of his devotees, like the liberation of Narakubhira Manjuri. He cannot do that when he's 10 years old.
Right. You understand? He's saying that Krishna's ages are... We're not going to get through many demons. Krishna's ages... So don't blame me. Krishna's ages are relative in the sense like he couldn't have killed Nalakrubira and Mani Griva when he was like 10 years old by pulling the grinding mortar. So it had to be done when he was very young. So that had to be, that was a specific pastime. And being very young, it accentuates his potency and his power. I mean, his first demon, Vatsasura, to kill Vatsasura, he's not even 5 years old. And he's killing this very heavy demon. And Agasura also.
They say that by...
By the way, Shruti Maharaj is the best storyteller. If you get a chance to hear him speak on Shakatasura or any of these demons, if you think I've included details, he knows far more details. But he's a little miserly with it. You have to squeeze him like a rasgulla. But it all comes out very juicy. All right.
It has been told by, I think, Jiva Goswami, that by killing Kutana, Krishna, he shows the power of his lips.
Yes, I've already described that. You haven't been here. I've gone into so much detail. And then Shakatasura feet and Trinavarata hands. These three aspects. Yeah. All. Oh. Gopal Champu, Ananda Vrindavan Champu, and Srila Krishna Chaturi Thakur is where I've taken everything from. But I've been telling a lot of details about each particular demon, so we've gone quite slowly. I thought it was better to go through the quality aspect during this time together, rather than just quickly go through them. So similarly now, there's about 8 demons left, still alive. But before I leave this room, they'll all be dead. We will finish them all. Because Rinda told me when I was coming here, I was bringing all these demons with me, but I have to make sure I drop them before I go. I don't want to take any back. So Pralambasura is the next demon. Pralambasura. Now remember, Krishna's age, again, is Poganda. He's about 7 years old. And this is chapter 18. And I already described the fire, the first forest fire. Actually, I made a mistake there. I said Krishna told the residents to close their eyes. He actually didn't tell the residents anything. I've checked through all the books, and it doesn't have any reference to Krishna indicating that they should close their eyes at all in the first forest fire. He just drinks that fire. There's no reference to him specifically saying close your eyes, but in the enthusiasm of telling the pastime, I said that. But it's not written that way. When we tell these pastimes, it's best not to try and exaggerate anything that's already written. It's best to try and stick, I like to stick, and I like to hear the very exact details as they've been written by the acharyas. If you personally start to elaborate and say, you know, there were 1,000 prominent puts on Kaliya, and then the next person will think that, and it'll just become, you know, away from the original. The original is sublime and perfect. So it doesn't mention at any time in that first forest fire that Krishna indicated everyone should close their eyes, as he did in the second forest fire. And then I described how they went back after Kaliya, after that night. Remember the story? He purified, chastised Kaliya, and then that forest fire came, because they all stayed that night on the bank of the Jumuna. And then the next day, they go back and they take the feast that was prepared for Baladev, and Raghuleka was telling me that Gurudev had said that by some remarkable potency, all of that foodstuff was kept completely fresh. It was totally fresh. So this is what the sequence is. So now again, Krishna is entering the forest again to continue his pastimes. He loves to go to the forest for many reasons, of course. Principally at this time, he's meeting his most beloved gopis. He can't meet them in the village atmosphere, but in the large forests where it's very secretive and there's lots of kunjas and there's all hidden places and caves and so on, especially on Govardhan Hill. Perfect opportunity to meet and play with the wonderful gopis. And Baladev also is meeting with the gopis at this time, as described. So now it's described that the summer manifests as spring because of Krishna's presence. And there are many waterfalls moistening the area with their drops of water. So there's a description that Shukadeva Goswami always opens out each chapter with, as I described before, the beauty of the setting of this spiritual kingdom of Braj. So it purifies the consciousness to hear these sweet descriptions. So the wind blew over the lakes and rivers, carrying the pollen of lotuses and water lilies. Very fragrant atmosphere for Krishna. Everything is surcharged with purity, goodness, and sweetness. This is Gokul, Vrindavan. Vrindavan was full of tender green grass, even though it was summertime, because the waves of the Jamuna would slash on her backs, on her banks. And as a result of that, beautiful tender grasses would come all on the banks of Jamuna. So the cows were very much nourished by this. And all the animal and bird life were made more attractive by the pleasant climate, atmosphere. And the boys, as we've described previously, would frolic so much in their games and so on, and they would decorate themselves with beautiful flowers and new leaves, colored minerals, peacock feathers, and they would sing beautifully. All of Krishna's Nitya Siddha Parikars are, every single one is such an exceptional personality. So when they sing, it's like singing that we could not even imagine. They would sing so beautifully. And Krishna would congratulate them on their singing. And sometimes, as I've described before, there would be games where sometimes the boys would pick on another boy and steal his lunch bag, etc. And if that boy started to weep or become unhappy, it's described Krishna would immediately go to that boy and embrace him and bring him back to a happy state of consciousness. He wouldn't allow that unhappiness to last for very long. But, and the demigods, they also disguised themselves, and they would come amongst the cowherd boys at that time. And they would take part in some of these games. And they would do things like arm wrestling, and they would leap around. It's described they would pull each other's hair. They would do all things that young boys do. This indicates intimacy, that this great personality, Parikshit Maharaj, he's listening to these sweet pastimes of young children. It's a very intimate point of conversation. So this is the nature of that intimacy. And then they would sometimes play as tax collectors, etc. Then on this particular day that we're describing now, in this beautiful, frolicsome atmosphere, then Pralamba, he disguised himself as a boy who hadn't been able to come to the pasturing grounds that day. His mother had kept him back. So then Pralamba took the shape of that particular boy. And he came in, and immediately, of course, Krishna, being omniscient, understood, detected, oh, we have a smelly demon in our company today. Because they always eat garlic and onions and stuff. They have a bit of a scent. And then he figures out, how am I going to kill this demon? And then he makes two teams, and in the two teams, one team has to hide, and then the other boys have to find where they're hidden. And if they find them, then they become victorious. But if they can't find them, then they're the losers. And the losers have to carry the winners on their backs. So he divides these two teams, one with Baladev at the head of one team, and Krishna at the head of the other team. And then, after playing this game for some time, it happens that Sriram will now carry Krishna, and Baladev has to be carried by Pralamba. And in this game, there's a particular drop-off point where they have to drop the boys up, carry them so far. But suddenly, this demon, Pralamba, with Baladev on his back. I already described that Sridhar is Krishna is carrying. Hang on. This happens a number of times, by the way, so it's not like black and white entirely.
Krishna is carried by, and Balaram is carried by.
Balaram is the leader of one group.
Yes, so Balaram being carried by,
so he lost.
And Krishna is carrying.
If Krishna lost.
Krishna is carrying Sridhar, that's what he said.
Baladev is being carried by Pralamba, and he suddenly realized this isn't an ordinary cowherd boy. He can feel, sense the strength of this boy, and he's gone beyond the drop-off point. And then he turns back to Krishna. What's happening here? And then Krishna throws him a glance. Wake up! Understand the nature of your real self. It's described, O soul of all, secret of all secrets, why are you acting like a human now? And suddenly Baladeva is again empowered by Krishna. Because Baladeva, you understand the reason for this, Baladeva becomes so immersed in these beautiful childhood pastimes, he forgets, just as Krishna also forgets, but because Krishna is Krishna, he never quite forgets. But Baladeva actually does forget. So when this demon's carrying him away, he actually becomes a little disturbed. And then when he realizes the nature of what's actually taking place, then he becomes as heavy as a mountain. And then this demon, he has to come to his proper huge size, which is massive. It doesn't describe exactly how massive, but he's very big. We get some indication by the size of Putana was 12 miles high, and Trinavrata went 800,000 miles into the sky. So we get some idea or indication of Pralamba. And Pralamba, by the way, he wasn't directly sent by Kamsa. Actually, he came to Kamsa, and Kamsa was very rude to him. Pralamba was very sort of submissive, like demons can sometimes be, and was saying, you know, why are you so much lamenting? I can actually go and kill Krishna, no problem. And Kamsa at that time said, oh, you are nothing, you can't do anything, you know, you're useless to me. And actually what he was doing, he was poking at Pralamba's pride, and then Pralamba thought, I'll show you now. So then he came, prompted by that stinging comment of Kamsa's. So now Pralamba is having to grow to his proper size to carry Balaram. And then Balaram, recognizing his own omniscience also, just punches him one time on the head, and then cracks his skull, is described. And then blood immediately. But Pralamba, when he manifested his full form, has beautiful ornaments, and it's described his body is very beautifully decorated, etc., as demons can do. And then when the boys become aware that Baladev has killed this massive demon, they become overjoyed and they start to glorify Baladev so much. So basically, this is the entirety of this pastime. There are many other details, but I'm going very quickly today because I want to cover a couple of demons. Otherwise, I won't get rid of them all before I leave. Maharaj, so,
just a short question. You said even the devatas, they took form of,
yes,
part of, but they are in Aishwarya Bhav. How can they mix in his Vajrila?
This is how Vishnu Chakravarti Thakur has described. It's a very good question because I also thought the same thing. It says the demigods also disguise themselves to take part in the games. So to the extent of their ability, they were playing the games, but the actual moods, they could never engender the same moods as these Nitya Siddha Parikars. But to some degree, they would just be there, you know, in some form, or not completely in mood, because the mood is the principle. So the bodies would be there, but the mood could not be there, as you said, because they are Aishwarya. They're not.
They would watch this. They would hide anyhow and watch.
So Vishnu Chakravarti Thakur is saying they would disguise themselves. This is from his commentary. They disguise themselves to take part in these pastimes. So you have to, so much of this is achintya. How can, as I've described before, we understand the different distances, etc., the sizes, the ages, you know, relating to our age, etc. So many aspects are inconsistent. If we don't enter this world with prayer, well, actually, we can't enter this world without a prayerful mood. It's impossible. It'll just be like, you know, a fairy story. But for the Vaishnava, for the devotee, it's sacred. It's his very life to hear these pastimes. And as I said initially, Parikshit is praised for wanting to hear these pastimes, which he's heard many times before. But he's praised by Shukadev to appreciate the ever-freshness of every single pastime. So Pralamba, he represents lust, for the opposite sex and desire for fame, adoration and distinction. And Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati, he comments that the worst form of desire for this fame is in the society of devotees themselves. If someone is in the society of devotees and they are seeking their own prominence, this is more abominable than seeking prominence just in the material world, because it's creating so much offense to those around you. There's always stronger and weaker personalities. So if the stronger at any time try to exploit the weaker, this is like a symptom of envy, and this is a very degraded mentality. So Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati, he comments on this mood in relationship to Pralamba. And it's described that previously he was Sudarshan, the brother of Suhotra, who became Bakasura. That was Suhotra became Bakasura. Garga Samhita says he was Vijay, the son of a Gandhava king named Kuhu. And he was cursed by Kuvera for stealing flowers. And Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur is commenting, we should try to appreciate and recognize these traits of pratishtha within us, and Guru will help to point them out to us, to illuminate them. It is Guru who actually is going to purify this anarta. In other words, Baladeva Prabhu is killing this demon, indicating Guru, but he's not going to do it directly for us. He will show us and indicate the anarta in our hearts. Prakashatma was speaking a few times about being ignored by Gurudev. This would be how Gurudev would perform his operations. He would just blank you for a few days, so you would start to think, what is my problem? And then you would have to internalize very deeply to find the problem. And the problem is, you know, not going to hide away from a focused eye. And then when you find it, purify. And then again, Gurudev would be very encouraging. But until that was cured, perhaps Gurudev would, you know, keep you at some distance, so that we ourselves have to purify these anartas. Quite simple. We must appreciate this. It's not, you know, something's going to be sprinkled all across our heads and all of a sudden everything will actually happen like Bhaktivedanta Prahlada Maharaj was saying yesterday. Some groups, they think that just by chanting a few rounds, etc., you will just go back to Godhead. What does it mean to go back to Godhead? We're discussing today what it means to go back to Godhead. Do we eagerly, very much want to take part in Krishna's childhood Vrindavan pastimes? Are we very anxious to hear these pastimes? Even more so the pastimes with the gopis, etc. What is our enthusiasm for that? This will indicate our eligibility to actually go to that realm of Braj. If you don't know where the realm of Braj is or about it, how can you possibly enter it? Possible. It doesn't happen that way. It wouldn't be sane. So then, after this attack by Pralamba, then it's described in the same chapter, chapter 19. Is it the same chapter? The following chapter. Pralamba was in the 18th chapter, and now Swallowing the Forest Fire is in the 19th chapter. I keep pointing out the chapter names and the ages, etc., to try and give us some breakdown on the 10th canto. If you break it down, because this is how Srila Vishnu Chakravarti Thakur has described it himself constantly. He's trying to give us access and entrance into this 10th canto. So it's not just an ocean of 90 chapters. It's defined and broken down, etc., so we can access it. So this is the 19th chapter, and again it's described that boys are enjoying their beautiful cowherd pastimes. And then the cows, it's described, were driven by greed for sweeter grass. and they enter the Munga Aranya. Mung, Aranya. Aranya means forest. Munga means what? Munga. Anyway, the Munga Aranya forest of very sharp canes, tall, sharp blades of grass. And it's in summertime. And they suddenly realize that they're lost. And they've also lost all the good grass as well, because they've entered into this place of not good grass. And they start to cry loudly. And meanwhile, the cowherd boys become very restless and unhappy, because actually they've lost their cows. They haven't performed their proper responsible duties. And they're very conscious of their duties that they have to perform. So then they hear them crying. So then immediately they track them down, they come to them in this forest. And then Krishna is described, he calls out to the cows to comfort them in his rumbling voice. Krishna's voice is so powerful that it carries across the airwaves to reach the cows, and they become encouraged by hearing the sound of Krishna's forest. But then at this point, suddenly a huge forest fire envelops the whole area, like where they are, encircles them completely. So Krishna very quickly runs into the amongst all the cows and the cowherd boys. And this fire is scorching heat. It's described that the fire was a friend of Pralambas. The demons can take all sorts of forms they want to, any sort of form. So this fire is described as a demon. And it actually represents an attack by the atheists and other antagonistic philosophies. This is what this second forest fire represents. Attack by atheists and other Mayavada, etc. philosophies. So now at this point, Krishna, he has to think, how will I consume this? I'm not going to just swallow this fire in front of all the boys, because I know what happened last time. I ate something that all the boys complained to Mother Yashoda when I ate some dirt. And if I just eat this fire in front of them, they'll go and complain to Mother Yashoda, oh, Krishna's eating fire. And Mother Yashoda will be very annoyed. So Krishna is very shy of his mother like this. He has to be very careful how he actually behaves. Mother is very full but sanyabar. This is the move we heard from about Srila Bhakti Pragyan Kesava Maharaj. His mother was very much, you know, an influence in his life like this. Similarly, Krishna is very much bound by the affection of his mother. Hearing it by the authorities gives us a very much alive picture of this Supreme Lord, of Krishna himself in his land of Braj. So what he does is true. Rajananda is commenting that he becomes more intelligent. Obviously, yeah, definitely. With his age, everything becomes more crooked with Krishna. So he tells all the cowherd boys to close their eyes. And the boys have seen Krishna kill Bakasura. They've seen him kill all these. So they think Krishna is someone very special. But if Krishna's special, that must mean we're special also, because we can defeat Krishna anytime. So that's how they're feeling, that they are as special as Krishna. Krishna's not exceptional. He's special, but we're special also. So they think that Krishna must know some mantra that he's supposed to chant when he's on his own in a solitary place. That's why he's told us to close our eyes. If we close our eyes, then Krishna will feel very much alone, and then the mantra will have potency, and they will be saved by this forest fire. So then they all very obediently close their eyes very carefully, thinking that Krishna is going to chant some mantra, and by that mantra, destroy the forest fire. But what does Krishna do? He's a little thirsty. So he transforms that whole fire into just a drop of nectar, it's described, and just drinks it like that. But even more than this, Krishna is so generous and thinking of their welfare at every moment. And because they've strayed so far from their usual grazing grounds, by his remarkable potency, even though it's Aishwarya, but as I described many days ago, that if the people who are witnessing this don't see it as Aishwarya, then really it's still what's called Naralila. It's not considered Aishwarya. But by his Aishwarya Shakti, he brings all of the boys and the cows to Bandirvat, this huge tree in Bandirvan. This tree is so big, actually, that its branches stretch right across the Jamuna. And there are days when the cowherd boys, they can run across this tree, which crosses over the Jamuna, while the cows, they swim underneath. So he brings them back to the beautiful shade of this Bandirvat tree. So, and then they open their eyes, and they're totally astonished that seeing themselves.
Is it really in Srimad Bhagavatam, the two forest fires are described?
Yes.
I never read in Krishna book. Oh, I don't remember.
No, no, it's in Krishna book. I also looked at today, actually, in Krishna book.
True story.
Yes, because straight after Kaliya, there's one forest fire. And now, after Pralamba, it's described as the second forest fire. And both have their different demoniac influences.
And Maharaj, is there a correlate? You just said how this fire represents atheistic Mayavad philosophy, etc.
Yeah.
And here's Krishna transforming it into a drop of nectar. So is there some understanding?
I would say answer to that question, just like Sannyasi Thakur in Jiva Dharma. He was a Brahman realized, Brahmagyani, realized soul. And that could be transformed into Vaishnavism by the potency of Premdas Babaji. He transformed that mentality. And how brilliant was Sannyasi Thakur afterwards as Vaishnavdas? How much could he defeat those Brahmanas? Because his mind had been purified by that philosophical study, etc. So sometimes you might meet someone who is actually, like Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya, for example, was the king of all Mayavads, practically. Brihaspati himself, Brahmananda realized, he's described. Vishnachakari Thakur describes in the third canto that Brihaspati's state of consciousness is Brahman realized. So Sarvabhauma, he was transformed to such an ecstatic, juicy devotee. So even more so, because he understood so many of the principles, etc., he would apply them. So does that satisfy? It's a nice comment. So now we come to this, I'm just going to go briefly here. The next demon takes place in chapter 23. So now we've jumped three very special sacred chapters. One is describing the rainy season. Now Srila Sukadeva Goswami, it's practically like he takes a deep breath after Pralamba, after this forest fire, and he wants to enter much more esoteric pastimes now. So first of all, he opens out the space, so to speak, by extensively describing the rainy season in Vrindavan. It's a very, very beautiful chapter. Actually, Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada did a whole book, The Life of the Bhagavad, in Japan, made a beautiful book describing all these natural settings and the beauty of the Vrindavan forest. So, and then he describes the Venugit and the stealing of the young gopis' clothes. These are three chapters between this Pralamba and this purifying, correcting the brahmanas, performing sacrifice. So there's an interim, there's a space here. This all adds to the glory. It's like sometimes it's described in music that the silence between the notes is part of the arrangement. It's not just the sound vibration, but it's the no sound between the sound, which also is part of the sound. So here, There's no demon described. There's only beauty, absolute sweetness. So then the gopis' clothes are, this is that chapter of Katyayani Vrat, is brought in at this time. That's chapter 22. So here, chapter 23. And it's quite amazing we're going to be able to speak this chapter, because Srila Bharati Maharaj the other day was referring to this chapter. And also Prakashatma yesterday in his class was referring to this chapter. So this chapter has many, many truths in this, or many aspects of profound interest for the devotees. And the boys, they appealed to Krishna again, like they did for the talm fruit, to satisfy their hunger. The boys were wandering in just out of where the village of Vrindavan is today. This pastime is taking place. If you're familiar with the road between Vrindavan and Mathura, you reach a halfway point called Akruragat. That's like the borderline between Vrindavan and Mathura. And in Mathura, it's a whole nother dimension, in fact. Gurudev used to say, not even a mosquito will go between Vrindavan and Mathura. So it's on the very edge of that place that this pastime is about to take place. Because every year during the Parikrama, we go to that place on the hill where this pastime took place, just beside Akruragat. Akruragat is in front towards Mathura, and then this Yagya Stali of the Brahmanas, what's that place called?
Batro.
We go there. So the boys are there, this is where they are, geographically. So you all know the geography of this place. So, and they're appealing to Krishna to satisfy their hunger. Now Krishna is understanding fully what is happening in this village of Batro, that these brahmanas are performing a yagya. For what purpose? They're performing a yagya to reach swaga. It's described by Shukadeva Goswami that they were advanced in age, but not in wisdom. That they were very foolish, they were bewildered by the material body, and they were going to fail to show respect to Krishna and Krishna's sakas. So then Krishna, he instructs his sakas, you should go and beg some food from the brahmanas who are performing this yagya, and they will give you some food. Just go like beggars. So all the coward sakas, coward boys, they go to, very respectfully, they approach the brahmanas and they make their petition. Oh, we are very hungry and Krishna is in the forest here with us, and please give us some food from your yagya. And the brahmanas don't even pay the slightest attention to them. They just ignore them completely. And the cowherd boys become a little disturbed by that. But then they start to explain, actually, that it's okay for the brahmanas to give them food at this stage of the yagya. And it's very insightful here, because it shows that the sakas understand everything about this sacrifice, more so than the brahmanas do. And there's a whole conversation here, where the boys, not conversation, but just the boys presenting all of the arguments, Shastric arguments, of why it's okay and completely bona fide to give us some food from the yagya. And they're saying all this to the brahmanas, and the brahmanas, out of their bewilderment, just completely, and fear, it's bewilderment and fear, they just completely ignore the cowherd boys. And then the boys, they come back very unhappily to Krishna without bringing any food, and they feel very despondent, a little depressed. And Krishna, what does he do? He laughs. He says, if you're a beggar, it means sometimes you will get and sometimes you won't get. You have to learn to tolerate however result is coming. Either way, if you get or you don't get. So Krishna, he laughed, because Krishna knew exactly. And then Krishna said, go to the wives of the brahmanas. But don't say that Krishna is hungry. If you say Krishna is hungry, they will faint. They will not be able to tolerate this. Just say, you are hungry. So what do the cowherd boys do? They go to the Brahmani wives, and they say, oh, Krishna's hungry. And what happens? The Brahmani wives, they faint to think that Krishna should be hungry. And the boys are looking at these women and wondering, why are they fainting? Why don't we just ask them for the food? And all of a sudden they're crying and they're falling on the ground and they're acting like this. And it's described that the boys are quite bewildered by the response that the Brahmanis are giving to them in the request for food. And then the Brahmanis, they come back to consciousness after their faint. And they chastise themselves for fainting. Oh, why did you faint? You know, wasting time when our beloved Krishna is so close in the forest, and not only that, he's hungry. He wants our service. So it's described by Srila Bharati, Bhaktivedanta Bharati Maharaj, just a couple of nights ago. Why are the Brahmanis so much more advanced than their husbands? You remember? Why? Why were they receptive to the boys more so than their husbands were? Huh? How did they get bhakti? Yes, but how did they get the bhakti? It doesn't just come. How they got bhakti? Come on. Educated audience, yeah? Sadhu Sangha. This is the only way that actually bhakti will manifest. This was the point that Srila Bharati Maharaj was making. That they had sadhu sangha. What was the sadhu sangha that the Brahmani wives had? What was it? No sadhus passing through there? No. So many realizes. What about the Malini, that flower lady? She came from Mathura, she came back many times before she just went away. And the Bethlehem sales people, many people would go trading into Braj, and they would speak of the wonderment and beauty of this young boy Krishna, and they heard through these personalities about the beauty and sweetness of Krishna. This was their sadhu sangha. This is how Gurudev has described what is their sadhu sangha. Where is Raghu Lekha? She was telling us. Anyway, she was, because she has a good memory for it. Anyway, Gurudev was saying like this, this was their sadhu, otherwise how could they have bhakti without sadhu sangha? Bhakti doesn't just come by itself, as Vishnu Chakravarti has explained in Madhuri Kadambini, that it's by sadhu sangha. All of our, this is the Siddhanta, sadhu sangha. So they had that sadhu sangha. So then when they heard that Krishna was hungry in the forest close by, they immediately, after they fainted and came back, they gathered themselves together and they took all of the very best preparations from the yajna and covered them nicely with cotton cloths, etc., in clay pots. And they put them on their heads and they carried them aside also. And their sons and their brothers and their fathers stood there with sticks to stop them going. The Brahmanas, they were aware of what was happening, and some of the Brahmanas left the yajna and they tried to obstruct their wives from going. Their wives were not going to be obstructed. They were completely like focused on the forest, and they just walked through that obstruction, listening to all the abuse of their husbands, threatening them if they came back they would kill them. That this was totally forbidden. What did they think they were doing? Going to the forest to feed cowherd boys? This was totally incorrect behavior. Nevertheless, this is exactly the same parallel as the gopis. When the gopis left their homes, what did they leave also? Not just their homes, they left their reputation. They left their varnashram principles. They left their shyness. They left everything that is considered of value in Indian culture. Everything they left, they gave it all up for what? For Krishna, to serve, render service to Krishna. So the Brahmanis were the same like this. It's described like an ocean liner, just they plowed through all this objection, except one lady. She could not. She was actually forcibly kept and held back in her house. And actually that lady, it's described in detail, she took Krishna into her heart, deep, and then she was embracing Krishna deep in her heart, and she left her material body. And immediately her spiritual body ran very quickly, flew to the forest to be with Krishna. And Krishna accepted that soul amongst his gopis. But only one actually had that situation happen. All the rest, they went. And they very quickly, as fast as they could go, with their wide hips and their full breasts, etc., carrying all these foodstuffs, and they came and they were hungrily looking for Krishna. And eventually they saw him through the trees, standing there with a shoulder, with his hand on a shoulder of Baladev. And was it Baladev? No. On the cowherd Sakam. I don't think Baladev was standing right there. And it's described that Krishna was twirling a lotus around in his hand when they came. And the Brahmanese, they were seeing this signal from Krishna swirling this lotus in two different ways, it's described. One, that Krishna was putting them into a swirling ocean of emotion about his beauty that they were first time experiencing. He, as if he was saying, I know the emotions that you're going through. It's swirling around like this lotus. But also, my heart is swirling around like this lotus. So he was indicating to them that there was a reciprocal relationship here. Very sweet indications here. You don't have to say these things just by eyes, by movements, by indications like this. So Krishna was indicating. And then the Brahmanis at that time, it's described, they also took Krishna. They knew that they couldn't embrace him in that circumstance. So they took Krishna, just like the lady, the Brahmani who left, deep into their hearts, and they embraced him for a long time within their hearts. And then Krishna was so sweet with them when they arrived. He said, oh, just like to the gopis when they first came, oh, why have you come? Please sit down, be comfortable. He told them, and then they all felt very relaxed and very comfortable. Now they had achieved life's goal. They were with the Lord of their life, Krishna. And then Krishna, he speaks some more endearing words to them. And then he says, it's revealed that Krishna's Leela Shakti would not agree to this being a compatible situation for Krishna to take Brahmani wives into the forest and stay with them. So it's described that Leela Shakti manifested some Aishwarya mood in the hearts of those Brahmanis of extreme worship towards Krishna. And this Aishwarya mood became the obstacle for the Brahmanis. And then Krishna, he's speaking to them very beautifully, but then says, now you have to go back to your homes, to your husbands and families. And the Brahmanis are totally distraught by this idea. And just like the gopis were, they tried to challenge Krishna. But the gopis succeeded in defeating Krishna. But the Brahmanis can't defeat Krishna because Krishna's Leela Shakti won't allow them to do that. So Krishna is saying, this is not correct. You're the wives of Brahmanas. It's not correct that you just stay in the forest with me. And then Krishna also says, I have girlfriends from the cow herd community. They are correct for me. But you are Brahmanas, Brahmanis. So this would not be a correct relationship, really. And there's a beautiful dialogue here between the Brahmanis and Krishna. They are trying to convince Krishna to allow them to stay. They said, oh, we don't want to actually become your girlfriends. We want to serve your girlfriends. And we want to take the discarded leaves that fall from your tulsi garland, and we will just live on that alone. Just stay in the forest, somewhere close to you. But Krishna, he says, no, no, you must go back and help your husband with the yajna, which they have started. And then they say, but if we go back, our husband's going to kill us. They've already told us that. They've already expelled us fully, and our brothers, etc. Krishna says, no, when you go back, I will arrange for the devas to manifest in their yajna, and the devas will explain to you the glories of your act in coming to the forest directly. So in doing this yajna, the Brahmanas after some time, and all the devas manifest and explain the situation. Who is Krishna? And then at this time, after the brahmanis get convinced, I'm going quite quickly, but after the brahmanis they get convinced to return to their homes, very sadly, you know, it's such a parallel to the gopis. We can read this because a few chapters on from this, the same thing is going to happen. But the Vrijavasi gopis, they stay with Krishna. So the brahmanis, they return, and as Krishna has said, all of their husbands and sons and brothers all become very, very honorable to them. They show them great respect. And the devas, they reveal the height of Krishna's personality, etc. And then the brahmanas, they condemn themselves. They said, we have performed so much sadhana and austerity, and our wives have done no austerity, and it doesn't look like they've done any sadhana. So this is a big lesson. It's not by sadhana and austerity that you will achieve Krishna. I said this the other day, Sri Krishna Chaitanya Thakur is commenting, that it's not by sadhana alone. That is not the principal ingredient. It is your attraction to Krishna, because we're conditioned souls. We can be approaching our sadhana like a materialist approaches his collection of money, just trying to clock up a lot of sanskars or sukriti. Oh, I'll do this and this and this and this and this, then I'll get a big bank account. But where is the softness of the heart unfolding? Where is that genuine attraction to Krishna actually manifesting? So it's definitely something beyond your sadhana. We have to do sadhana, you have nothing else to do. You know, and we have to do some austerity. This is also pleasing to Krishna. If you read, like in the second chapter of Vaikanisvara, I was talking the other day, in this chapter, Shloki, chapter 9 of the second canto, Krishna says directly, I am bought by austerity. He's telling Lord Brahma. Lord Brahma performs this austerity of the tapa. He hears the sound vibration. And then when he comes to Krishna, Krishna says, austerity is my life. But here he's saying, actually, I am not bought by austerity. Only devotees can reconcile this. Only by chanting this powerful Maha Mantra can we... It's not so difficult, really, to reconcile. Can you reconcile? Krishna's saying one time, austerity, and he's saying another time, austerity will bring us to a certain state of consciousness, but after that state of consciousness, something else is needed. Something much more significant. It's sadhu sangha is needed to see the example of that person who has melted towards Krishna. That is imperative. Without that sadhu sangha, you will never understand actually what it means to properly render service to Krishna for no expectation of anything for ourselves.
So Lord Brahma didn't have any sadhu sangha, so Krishna is giving him everything just through austerity.
Correct, correct, absolutely correct. Very nice point. Lord Brahma didn't have any sadhu sangha outside of Krishna. He had Divya Sarasvati chant the Gopal mantra initially, but no sadhu sangha. Very good point. But understand this contrast. It's not by austerity. It doesn't matter how early you get up in the morning, how many, you know, laps of rounds you chant there. Gurudev used to say this many times. He talked about Haridas Thakur would chant 3 lakhs of rounds a day. But Rupa Goswami would say one name of Krishna and be in complete bhava. The contrast. So both are there. And we have to reconcile intelligently according to the time, place and circumstance. If we're speaking this to people, sometimes you'll have to encourage austerity. And sometimes you'll have to encourage something beyond austerity. Definitely the two are there, have to be considered.
Srila Bhaktivinoda certainly encouraged with that example where he said, if you want to put water in a glass, you don't need to focus on taking the air out first. Put the water in, the air comes out.
Very nice. Gurudev says the same. Yes. Mara.
Two fingers.
Yes, Chaista and Kripa. When Krishna is being bound by Mother Yashoda, these two fingers, what do they represent? Chaista and Kripa. What is Chaista? It means effort. My effort. There's no relationship without my participation. So my effort must be there. Otherwise, it's just like robotic, and that's not the nature of spiritual reality, is it? It's about the condition of the heart and its meltability towards Krishna, the attraction. This is the whole purpose of describing these different pastimes through these weeks that I offered this seminar, to the best of my ability, is to attract us to Krishna, attract us to that land of brush. This is the principle of going through this, and to appreciate simultaneously. So, just to conclude the pastime, when the brahmanas realized their great mistake, they lamented deeply that they didn't have the courage, really, to actually worship Krishna. They were afraid of Kamsa. Kamsa has his spies everywhere. It's like I described in the other pastimes when Agastura had all the cowherd boys and calves in his stomach. Kamsa's spies told Kamsa, they all became very happy. Oh, all the cowards and cowherd boys have been killed in Agastura's stomach. So these spies, so the brahmanas were aware of that. So when they were performing that yajna, they were afraid to actually go and offer, even after the devas told them about the personality of Krishna. Even though they had been enlightened, they still were afraid to go to the forest and offer pranams to Krishna. They still continued, you know, to their yajna. So there are many, many more details. Actually, this is a most splendid pastime that we should read with depth and significance regularly. If we regularly absorb something of these Leela pastimes, then of course we're coming closer to Braj, we're coming closer to Krishna. So I try to describe them in much detail so that we can get a real atmosphere of that those pastimes in Braj. So then there's the next pastime is the overcoming the pride of Indra. That's a long pastime and very, very beautiful. But finally Indra's pride becomes purified. We all know the pastime. But I'm just offloading here the last few demons in about 2 minutes, 3 minutes. I'm going to just drop them all. And then Nanda Baba is attacked by the servant of Varuna and taken to that abode of Varunadeva in the waters. That's a very beautiful pastime in Gopalchampu. It describes it very amazing. They go down some deep tunnel and then Varunadeva, when he hears that Krishna is coming, he runs to the entrance of his palace in anticipation, waiting for Krishna. He's quite afraid, thinking he's made some offense also. So he wants to be welcoming him and welcomes Krishna. And then he, when Krishna comes, he immediately presents Nanda Baba, and Nanda Baba is amazed at the opulence of Varuna, and comes back and tells all the cowherd boys, and then there's the beautiful pastime, her men, gopas, that they want to go to Brahmaloka, they want to go to these higher places, they want to go to Goloka. So then there's the beautiful pastime of that unfolding, which is very powerful and deep pastime. So then, after that, it's Nanda, he becomes swallowed by a snake. They go to perform Shiva Ratri, and it's in the evening time, and Nanda gets swallowed by a snake, and all the cowherd men come with burning sticks and try to burn this snake, but the snake won't give up Nanda, and eventually Krishna comes with his foot and just touches that snake, who immediately transforms into a Vidyadhara. A Vidyadhara is higher than even the demigods, a very exalted personality, and there's a whole story behind that also, but that was the demon, that snake demon that attacked Nanda. And then there's the Sankachuda demon, only two or three more. The Sankachuda demon, where Sankachuda tries to steal the gopis right in front of Krishna Balaram. It's very beautiful. And then Krishna chases that Sankachuda demon and splits his head with one whack of the side of his hand.
Gorilla, right?
No, that was Dravida. Vidvida. No. Sankachuda. He was like a demon. And Krishna takes the jewel This is the shaman Takajul. He's taking from Sampachuda. And he wants to give it to Radha, but he can't give it directly to Radha in front of the other gopis, or great politics will arise. Oh, who is the greatest gopi, just like with Rukmini? So he gives it to Balaram, Balaram gives it to Madhumangal, Madhumangal gives it to Vishaka, Vishaka gives it to Lalita, and Lalita gives it to Radha. So this Shamantaka jewel is eventually given to Radha. But how does that Shamantaka jewel end up in Dwarka later? Do you know? That same Shamantaka jewel is owned by Satrajit in the pastime of making so much gold. So there's a time when Sri Radha, she wants to give up her life and she goes into the Jamuna. And Jamuna is the daughter of Suryadev. So Jamuna takes her to her father, Suryadev. And that is the transition from Radha to Satyabhama. And Satyabhama at that time goes to Dwarka. And at that time, Suryadev becomes pleased with the offerings of Satrajit and gives him the Shamantaka jewel in the same house as Satyabhama. Satyabhama is the daughter of Satrajit. So that's the story. Very quickly, I said it just in a sentence, anyway. And then there is the Aristasura demon. We all know this demon. This was the beginning of the manifestation of Radhakund. So this bull demon comes into Braj and then is destroyed again by Krishna. And then the gopis, they challenge Krishna, you've killed the bull, so you must take bath in all the sacred rivers. So then Krishna, with his heel, he just makes a little hole and calls all the sacred rivers. And then Sri Radha sees the splendor of his kund, and she wants to make a kund herself. And there's a hoof mark left by Aristasura, this huge bull demon. And they excavate around there just with their bracelets. They take their bracelets and they make a huge kund. And then they start to bring the waters of Manasi Ganga to their kund, and Krishna beseeches them, oh, you just take from my kund. And Radharani says, no, it's all contaminated. You killed a bull, you've been swimming in there. And then Krishna calls all the holy tirthas and he says, please go and petition Sri Radha. And there's many beautiful prayers that they petition Sri Radha to be allowed to enter her kund. And then after this petitioning, Radha becomes very much melted and she says, okay, you can come into my kund. And then the walls break between Shamakund and Radhakund, that's the Sangam. And then all the waters from Shamakund come into Radhakund. And then Krishna proclaims, this is the most glorious and highest place in all of existence. I will take my bath here every single day. And Sri Radha says, and I will take my bath in Shamakund every day. And Krishna says, but Radhakund will become more famous than Shamakund. Yeah. And Radha is satisfied. This has to be the dynamic that Radha is always, you know, to satisfy. Swadhinavarkaka. So that's Aristasura. And then his Keshi demon, the big horse demon, comes furious, his mane running with the clouds, to kill Krishna. And Krishna very easily puts his hand into the horse's mouth and his arm expands like iron. It's described, the teeth of Keshi immediately fall out as soon as they touch his, which is really like a soft lotus hand, because none of these demons have been killed by Krishna. It's all the Vishnu aspect within Krishna, his Shaktis, which are actually killing these demons, not Krishna. Krishna just went to pat the horse and the horse died. What was this his fault? It was no fault of his. This is how Srila Jiva Goswami explains. Krishna didn't take any aggressive action. So then he bangs the horse up and down and of course leaves his body. So this is Keshi demon. And then Vyomasura is the last demon in Braj, who is like an air demon come to attack Krishna in the forest. And Krishna, very easily, he fights with him in the sky. And actually you can go near Uchagal in Varshana and you can see the marks. I think, oh yes, in Kamyavan, sorry. In Kamyavan. Yeah, well, you can see the cave of the Vyomasura. We go there. So just above the cave, there's markings of the crown.
And also the necklace.
And Krishna's necklace are there in the rocks. So, And Baladev had to steady the earth because the earth was rocking so much with the jumping of Vyomasura. Vyoma means sky, like para Vyoma. Sky, the greatest sky is Karagyoma. So Vyoma, that's the nature of that demon. He was the last demon. Because prior to these, Keshi and Vyoma, they happened very quickly, like one day is one and one day is the next. Because Narada has already described to Krishna about what other demons he must kill in the rest of India. So then Krishna winds up his Braj pastimes, and to the distraction of the gopis, he goes to Mathura with Akrura. So that's just very briefly those last few demons. But get an idea of the details that have been revealed through the acharyas, through Jiva Goswami in particular, in his Gopa Champu, and Ananda Vrindavan Champu by Kavi Kanpur, and the commentaries by Śrīla Vishnāda Chakravarti Thakura in the 10th canto, and the lectures and files of our beloved Gurudev, who has described these pastimes so many times to inspire us into that land of Braj. So I hope this presentation has been of benefit to inspiring a mood towards Vrindavan within you. And we should read these regularly. So this is the conclusion of my talk. And in India, if musicians travel or different people travel to give lectures or concerts, they very often travel with lots of gifts to give to the audience in appreciation for their coming to actually listen. So I don't have any physical gifts to give you, but my mind, I would like to offer you all a cow and a calf. Only one. I was thinking to offer you 100, but actually you wouldn't be able to carry them. But if I can offer you one, my mind, and a calf, so it's a milking cow, so you can have that. And I also have some Rajapun water directly. If you want to come up and I'll give you a little bit. But it's very kind of you to have come and listen to these pastimes, because only by having an opportunity to speak these pastimes can they really significantly arise in our hearts. When we read them, it's very wonderful. But if ever we have a chance to actually put the vibration out into the ether, it becomes magnified in our heart. It becomes much more potent and much more real. So, and describe them according, like I described all the different details previously. It's very, very helpful for our bhakti. It will enliven us towards that land of Braj. And of course, Navadvip Dharam is no different to Braj. We're just going there now, so that's a different exception. So thank you very much. Don't forget your cows and calves. You'll have one cow and one calf.
I don't want it. I'm living in Paris. What am I going to do with it?
You're a Brahmin. You have to donate it then. Before you go, you'll have to donate it to someone.
Donate it to Nusinga.
This is what the Brahmin is doing.